Anybody has money for the body? Anybody has money for the body? everybody for the last time. Anybody else say anything for everybody for the last time? Anybody else say anything for everybody for the last time? Stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin womb destroyed this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eye shall behold not another. We brought nothing into this world, and it is indeed certain we carry nothing. Remain standing, please. You got it here this morning or this afternoon on this solemn occasion of our dear sister, Lolita Isola Woods, of going to be the Lord. AKA Lolita Joseph. Lottie Joseph, sorry. We welcome you here in Fundamental Baptist Church this afternoon. Those who are friends, family, or whatever it may be, you're gathered here this afternoon, to celebrate the life of this precious lady whom the Lord took home a few days ago. So that's what we're here this afternoon for. So celebrate the life. She's not here with us anymore, but I hope and pray that you will put your voices together. You not only cry, but put your voices together and give her a good send away, I would say. All right? Are you ready for that this afternoon? Before we do that, let us bow for prayer at this moment. Father, this afternoon, we thank you for your love and for your mercy. We thank you for this moment, dear Father, that those who are bereaved, you will bring comfort in their lives, those that we know and those that we don't even know. But all we have come here this afternoon to support this solemn occasion. Let us now we pray in Christ's name. Amen and amen. You may be seated at this moment. We have a first scripture reading before anything, before any songs. We have a first scripture reading by the Lesher Peters. Denelsa Peters. Everybody would have a song, but you have a thing? You have a scripture?
Okay. In my cooking?
Yes, it's in my. Speak loud in the mic. I'm different.
Okay. Good afternoon. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we all shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on corruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall we brought to pass the saying that is written, that is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grief, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
We have a special song at this moment. Alicia, the granddaughter. She is around. Okay, we'll continue. We'll have open tributes now. Open tributes. And I will tell you that we have to go to Kalakwa. So don't take the whole afternoon. Okay? Make it short and sweet. Short and sweet. The sun is hot. We have to go to Kalakwa. Short and sweet. All right. Open tributes.
A pleasant good afternoon to the family, praise the Lord, of the deceased. I want to give an opening tribute to the family because we was living very close. And I am concerned of the people of Choppins. No, I just want to give this first. Put it on the coffin there for me. So while I sing the hymn, praise the Lord. Share the flowers now. Now the time has come for leaving, and she shall be a few. Don't spend your money on flowers. Just a rose will do. She will go to the beautiful garden. At last, when life walks is through, flowers, just a rose will do. Just how an old-fashioned preacher's preaches a sermon so true. She need no beautiful flowers, just a rose will do. She will go to the beautiful garden at last when life walks is true. Oh, don't spend your money on flowers, just a rose. She need no organization just to make a view. She need no bright decoration, just a rose will do. She will go to that beautiful garden at last when life walks is true. Don't spend your money on flowers, just a rose will do.
We are open tributes, and if you knew that lady well and a good interaction with her, you must come here and say something about her, okay? If you knew who she was, you interacted with her, come here and something good about her. Now is the time. Come on, people from Choppins. Don't do that to her.
Good afternoon, everyone. Just like to say condolences to the Joseph and the whole family of Choppins and elsewhere. Well, all my 40 years living in Choppins, right? I never, ever heard Miss Lottie with a soul. She was loving, friendly, very quiet, and I know she loved all her grandchildren. And anybody could pass by Miss Lottie and they are all welcome. Isn't that true? Right. So I just love to say, may her soul rest in peace until we meet again. Thank you.
Come on, church, come on.
Dark of the midnight, have I always
Whether you reach 100 or 1,000 until you subside. So those are the things that
we do as human beings, one to another, because all of us have to live here and out and enjoy and depend on each other. So on behalf of myself, the family, my family and friends, and well-wishers of the village, we want to extend our deepest condolences to her. Up to Friday, the Prime Minister was in Washington, so and I haven't gotten in touch with him, so I don't know if he is back, but he asked me to express, if he's not back, his deepest condolences to the family of the bereaved. May her soul rest in perfect peace and perfect.
Amen.
You may.
the morning is coming. So hold on to Jesus, everybody. But ride out your storm.
No, Lisha, wrong, sir. Don't say right. Okay. Okay, we have another song again by Ashley Joseph. And followed by the scripture, secondary scripture reading. Kala.
Kala team.
Team. Okay. Get ready. For the second reading.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is a tribute from my grandmother to my great-grandmother. Thank you.
Afternoon, church. The scripture reading is taken from St. John chapter 5. This one? Okay. St. John chapter 5 from verses 25 to 29. Verily, verily, I said unto you, the hour is coming, and now it is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they shall hear it, they shall live. For the Father had it in himself that he had given into the Son to him that himself, and he had given unto authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in which all are in the graves and shall hear his voice, and shall come forth they that have good unto resurrection of life, and they have done evil unto resurrection of domination. Here ends the scripture verse reading.
Thank you. As we stand, as we sing, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Put our voices together. As we sing, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. After this, we're going to have this third scripture reading. Shirian, you ready? Salian, ready? The daughter, after the song. Blessed Assurance, to sing.
Blessed Assurance,
Jesus is mine.
Come on, sing on, sing on.
This is my story. This is my song.
Good afternoon, everyone. The scripture reading is taken from Romans chapter 8, verses 35 to 37. And I read, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us." This is the end of the scripture reading.
Okay, thank you very much, Salian. Next song, and after this we have the eulogy. Do the land.
I've reached the land of corn and wine, and all its riches bring in mind. Flesh has a meat, what is for me? For all my night has passed away. I'm
Lottie Isola Woods, also known as Lottie Isola Joseph, was born on October 7th, 1935. She was commonly known as Miss Lottie to some people, but to the majority of us, she was simply Mama. Mama, a name that eternally springs love and affection, which is the way we will always remember her. Daughter for Naomi. In fact, Naomi only had two daughters among her 17 children, Mama and Auntie Rosita. Mama was born in Stubbs, the native village of her mother, and spent some of her childhood there before moving to Choppins. The move to Choppins was inspired by Naomi's search for work. In the late 1930s and early 1940s, St. Vincent and the Grenadines was still very much a plantation economy, and employment for the masses was driven by the estates. One of these estates was the Harmony Hall Estate. The hard-working Naomi found employment at Harmony Hall Estate that was owned by the Hathaway family. To facilitate her work on the estate, she was allowed to build a house at Manginere upon the hill in Choppins, which was in close proximity to the estate. Mama was now a resident of Choppins, and a new chapter in her life was about to begin. She attended the Brighton Methodist School, but most of those primary school years were spent assisting her mother on the estate. Her younger sister, Auntie Rosita, told me of those days when their mother would tie an apron around their waist and take them into the fields with her to pick cotton. They would pick the cotton from the trees and put it into a pouch in the apron. And when the apron was full, it was emptied into a basket. They would then take the cotton to a shed where they will help to separate the purest white cotton from the rest. It was hard and careful work, and certainly a huge responsibility to be undertaken by children. This early introduction to hard work was a preparation for her later life when she became a mother and had to raise most of her children mostly on her own. Away from the estate, Naomi's house and yard provided a space for Mama to be a normal child, playing and laughing with her siblings. As the two only girls, it is easy to understand why she and Auntie Rosita developed a special bond and spent a lot of time together. Auntie Rosita told me about those moonlight nights when the moon was just a big lantern in the sky, and Naomi's yard came alive with running and hiding and screaming and laughing as they played hide and seek, which was Mama's favorite game. Auntie Rosita told me that Mama was the hardest to find because she was so good at hiding. They would look for her until they were tired, and when they declared that they had given up, she would emerge from her hiding place, bursting with loud laughter. Naomi always kept a garden in her yard, and Mama always found a new place in the garden to hide. One of our favorite places to hide was among the cassava roots in the garden. As the eldest of the sisters, and in keeping with the tradition of that time, Mama was expected to take the lead in assisting her mother with tasks such as washing and cooking. She and Auntie Rosita used to go from Choppins to a dam down at Riviere to wash, and they used to take a cutlass with them. After washing, they would put the clothes to dry and go with their cutlass to Coffee's land to dig sweet potatoes. When they returned home, they would cook the potatoes for lunch. Everyone told me that Mama was very quiet and friendly growing up. They said that she was a peacemaker. If there were squabbles among her brothers, she did not pick sides. All you behave all yourself. That is what she would say. And even up to the day of her death, she remained that way. The quiet peacemaker who hardly ever raised her voice in anger. As Mama got older, she began to bloom into one of the beauties on the estate. And this bloom had consequences. She became pregnant with her first child, Uncle Arnold. 10 more children followed over the years. Uncle Winston, Uncle Alfred, Auntie Esther, Veronica, my mother, Uncle Obi, Auntie Bev, Uncle Charlie, Uncle John Boops, Auntie Gloria, and Uncle Glaston. Like her mother Naomi, Mama worked hard to take care of her children. She nurtured them with love, advancing none above the other. Each of them had an equal place in her heart. When she moved on from the Harmony Hall estate, she started working with Hobbs Huggins, assisting with laboring on their farm and also doing domestic chores at their house in Goldenville. My cousins and I used to wait for her sometimes after school because she always had some kind of delightful treat to pop into our mouths. Her final place of employment was at the home of Miss Veronica John at Villa, better known as VJ's. Mama worked hard and honestly to make a living, leaving home early on mornings and returning home at evening, tired and drained, but willing to wake up the next day and do it all over again. Because, as she always said, she did not want her children to have to beg anyone for anything. Values that will help them to be better men and women. She taught them to be respectful to their elders. If for whatever reason she and an adult were not on good terms, her children were still expected to say good morning, good afternoon, good night to Mrs. Who or Mrs. Will. She taught them to appreciate the little that they were given and not to covet what other people had. She taught them the value of sticking together as brothers and sisters and encouraged them to settle conflicts among themselves internally instead of having to wash dirty clothes in public. Mama ran a family that was close-knit, and even when some of her children left home to start families of their own, she remained connected to them. For example, I remember having to take food from Choppins to Glen for Uncle Arnold every Sunday. I think it is now safe for me to admit that Kenroy and I used to eat pieces of chicken. Kenroy and I used to eat pieces of chicken and pie from the basket under Robbie Mango Tree. Yeah, we may sound like bad children, but please put your feet in our shoes. We had to take that basket of food from Choppins to Glen before we ourselves had eaten. So just imagine having to walk so far on a hungry belly with that basket, with baked chicken and baked pie, enticing your nostrils. Be honest, what would you have done? Especially when you consider how irresistible Mama's cooking was. Yes, she really was a great cook. It was Mama who engendered my love for coconut dumplings and sauce food in general. I remember her baking bread and cakes and doughboy in an old drum oven in an outside kitchen. And up to this day, I am still convinced that a drum oven makes everything taste better. It was Mama who made me develop a special love for carrot juice, because when I was studying for my CXE exams, she used to make carrot juice for me every day. It is good for your eyes and your brain, she used to tell me. I was fortunate to spend my childhood growing up in an extended family with Mama and the father of her last four children, Aldi, whom we used to refer to as Daddy. Aldi died when he was just 41 years old, leaving behind a relatively young Mama to lead the family into one of the most difficult periods of our lives. 2 years after the death of her beloved Aldi, another tragedy struck, Tropical Storm Gilbert. Tropical Storm Gilbert brought rain and winds to St. Vincent that caused our family home to collapse. Fortunately, the only casualty was our dog Superman, crushed under the collapsed house. We had to gather ourselves together and start a new journey, literally uphill, moving from Dung below, where we used to call Tank, moving up to Cross Street. Mama, our superwoman, our matriarch, she was the one to hold the family together in that difficult period. She was the one to mend the scattered pieces. She was the one to pull us up the mountain to a new life. As the years went by, the extended family splintered into nuclear families with grandchildren and great-grandchildren and even great-great-grandchildren. But Mama remained the center of everything. People grew, people moved out, people moved on, but Mama remained the glue that held this Joseph family together. A memorable time in her life was when she traveled to Canada to reconnect with her two youngest children, Gloria and Glaston. She spent 1 year abroad with them and brought back items from that trip that she kept in a suitcase under her bed right up to her death. Before going to Canada, she had traveled to Cuba as part of the Vision Now program to do surgery on her eyes. She spoke fondly of that trip to Cuba, and it consolidated her love for Ralph and labor. It was therefore common to see her sitting on her porch in a special corner of the house, looking out onto the road and listening to Star Radio. Mama's house at Cross Street was opened to everyone, and I mean everyone. The house was wide open like her heart, letting everyone in, showing no one a bad face. One of the persons who Mama was close to in her latter years was Uncle Tommy. I remember that they used to spend so much time together that people started gossiping. Boy, like Uncle Tommy and Mama Lyman. But I believe that their friendship was pure. Two elderly people genuinely appreciating each other and enjoying each other's company. Well, there were two special people whose company Mama really enjoyed in her latter days. Two of her great grandchildren, and I really feel the need to say this. Because they were faithfully at Mama's side, Desran and Desari. They were her special little helpers. Desran used to look forward to Mama's ginger tea each morning. After drinking Mama's ginger tea, Desran would say, "Mama, your ginger ale tastes good." Desari was the one to do anything for her, whether it was going to the shop or bringing her a cup of water. The commitment of Desran and Desari to Mama tells the story of how her love and affection touched generation after generation, and how we have always felt the need to reciprocate that love and affection. Mama was a regular churchgoer, having been baptized into the Choppins Fundamental Baptist Church. Yes, this very church. I remember that the late Pastor Bunidi referred to her as Mother Jo. So she lies in this church today, not as a stranger, but as one of its pillars. They say all good things must come to an end, and regardless of how good Mama was, regardless of how good any of us may be, death is an inevitable end. On September 12th at 2:49 p.m., I received a text message from my niece, Sasha. I was at work. The message said, Mama passed. The message was so simple, just like the way Mama lived her life in simplicity. Mama was the mountain of our family. She was the highest peak. She was our calm among the storm. She was the peacemaker. Her bosom was a place of comfort and refuge, and I still remember how her bosom smelled like sweet powder when I was a child. I mentioned earlier how Mama and Auntie Rosita used to help their mother pick cotton on the estate, and how in the end they had to help to separate the purest cotton from the rest. Well, I think God has picked one of the purest type of cotton from our garden. He has picked Mama. She has gone into his garden to be reunited with her beloved Aldi. I believe that Aldi held her hand as she crossed that bridge between life and death. I believe that there was an aisle and they both walked down that aisle, and I believe that there were angels blowing their trumpets as this couple walked hand in hand into eternity. Maybe it's just me and my fanciful imagination, but it's comforting to think of such a lovely woman leaving this world in such a lovely way. Mama, may your soul continue to rest in peace.
Fourth scripture reading, I said it before, fourth scripture reading.
Good afternoon, everyone. The scripture reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 14 to 17. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Here is the scripture reading.
Thank you very much. We have come to the part that I have to play now. And I know many of you all didn't work with no Bibles. So I'll read for you this afternoon. And I'll preach for you this afternoon from the Word of God. I am speaking to you from the 2 Corinthians chapter 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And I'm going to read two verses. Maybe those of you who have your tablet, whatever it is, you can follow me. Because that's the game now. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And I'll read two verses. And I will concentrate on verse 2. I have used that text before. And I'm going to use it this afternoon because I think it is a very appropriate to use it. So I read, "We then, as workers together with him, beseech you also that you receive not the grace of God in vain. For he saith, I have heard thee in time accepted, and the day of salvation I have helped thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." Do you get that? The last part. "Behold, now is the day of salvation." Let us bow for prayer. Father, this afternoon, we thank you again that the word will speak to us. We have celebrated the life, continue to celebrate the life of our dear sister Lottie. But now, as we come to the word, we pray, dear Lord, that you will speak to hearts. Let the Holy Spirit work and empower me this afternoon to bring the very simple message that will touch the lives of those who are here this afternoon without you. Speak to us, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen and amen. Well, we have already eulogized our sister Lord this afternoon. Great testimony. We all heard that. And now we have come to the place where we have to present the word to you who are alive. She has already departed from here. She has already been in the arms of the Lord Jesus Christ, because the Apostle Paul gave her that assurance to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Do you know that verse? Absent from the body, present the Lord. That means she is no longer with us. And for those of you who have not yet trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, I want to bring that message to you today, because I'm speaking to the word now. Now is the time. Now is the time. Just as the Apostle Paul said it here, the same way I'm going to give it to you. Now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Now is the time. The Apostle Paul was quoting from the book of Isaiah, chapter 49 and verse 8, where the prophet had spoken of a time on a day in which grace and salvation may be obtained. He spoke about that many, many years ago. I want to say to you this afternoon, that time has come. The time is now. The gospel dispensation, my friends, it is now. So is the era of grace. So Paul made some strong points when he comes to salvation. When it comes to salvation, he made some strong points. And he said, now is the time for salvation. In other words, if you are not saved, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, now is the time. You hear me this afternoon? Now is the time. It has nothing to do with going to church. It is a matter between you and Christ. A decision that you have to make. A personal decision that you have to make. And Paul is saying, now is the time. And as I said, Paul used simple words that we all can understand. He used the word now. He used the word time. He used the word accepted. And the word day in that verse this afternoon. And I want you to remember that this afternoon. The word now is in reference to salvation. It means at this present moment. The word now, that's what it means. At this, it is reference to salvation. It means at this present moment. If you have not accepted the Lord's offer of salvation, you must make that decision. Now is the time. To delay, my friends, this afternoon, to delay can be
detrimental. Solomon, in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 1, used the word now. He said, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth. And Solomon did not only stop there. Solomon went on to give us reasons why we need to remember now the Creator. Why we need to remember him now. He gave us some reasons. Why? He said, one day to come, we will get old. Are we getting old? We are getting there. No matter what you want to do, we are getting there. He said, one of these days, slowly but surely, we will get old. And no matter what you want to do, as I said it before, and I said again, no matter what we want to do, we can go anywhere, we can polish ourselves, we can do, well, we are men now going bald head. We men doing their hair. We're trying to keep ourselves young. But Solomon said, surely, we are going to get there. Slowly. We are going to get there. And we're going to get feeble. Have you seen this advert? You understand that? He said, we are going to get there. The things that you are doing when you are young. Now some of us cannot do it. That is telling us we are getting old. And Solomon said, before you get old and feeble, and before you die, remember the Creator. Make him part of your life. Making part of your life. I'm getting old. My hair is telling me so. We're getting there. And Pope Solomon is saying, before you get there, remember the Creator. Remember him. Now is the time. Paul used the word now twice in the same chapter. He said, accepted. Now is the accepted time. That is, now is the time to do it. In fact, if you have not done it, you need to do it. Why? Because you cannot receive it when you want, my friends. You cannot receive God's salvation when you want. It is not on our time. It's God's time. Not when you want to do it. People usually say, I am not ready for it yet. But according to this verse, my friend, salvation is on God's time. And now is truly the time for you to come and receive it while the door of grace is still open. To you and to others who do not know Christ as Savior. Because in Genesis chapter 6 and verse 3, the Lord God said in the days of Noah, I'll speak to you. There will come a time for that. And Paul here deals with time in that verse, because many people believe, many of us said this afternoon, believe that we have time. But let me say this afternoon, my friend, time is slipping away from us. We think we have time. We believe we have time. But time is slipping away from us. Paul is saying, now is the day of salvation. The day to which Paul refers, my friend, is the time between the rising and the setting of the sun. That's the day he's speaking about. That's the day he's speaking about. When you have the opportunity and the time, maybe to hear the gospel. Because you may not have that opportunity again. Because many of you here this afternoon have heard the gospel, have heard the word of God before, but have failed to believe it and have failed to receive it. Failed to receive it. Failed to receive Christ as Lord and Savior. Because again I said, you believe that you have time. Right now you may not see the need for salvation. You may not see the need. But salvation is important. Salvation, my friend, is not in the church. Salvation is not in water baptism. My friend, salvation is not in church membership. Salvation is in Jesus Christ. Is in Jesus Christ. You must receive him. You must have him. The Bible tells us so. In Philippians 6, Acts chapter 16, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Salvation is in Christ. Life is in Christ. He that have the Son have life. Is in Christ. Nothing else. And God is saying to you this afternoon, if you don't know his Son, you need to receive him as your Savior. And he's saying to you this afternoon, now is the time for you to make up your mind and make that decision and receive his Son in your life. You think when you die, God is asking you which church you go to? They're going to ask you that. He's not looking for that, my friend. He is looking for his Son in your life. He's asking you which church you baptize into. That's his concern. He's looking for his Son. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ, that's what we are preaching. That's what we are telling this afternoon. Now is the time to make up your mind. You're not getting younger. We are not getting younger. We are getting older. Some of you all here have not received Christ as Savior. And you believe we have time. We don't have no time. She thought she had time. But praise God, before my dear sister passed away, she made her life straight or right with God. Oh, what a blessing. We can cry this afternoon and we can laugh because we know where she is. Oh, what a beautiful thing this afternoon. Yeah, we can cry. I can cry because I knew her. She was to come to church when she was very strong. But I missed her. She used to come. She never missed church when she's all right. But she makes a path right with God. And today we can cry and we can rejoice. And those of us who are saved, we have the same assurance that she has. That one of these days, oh my Lord. One of these days, we're going to see her again. All depends, all because of Jesus Christ. Are you saved this afternoon? Do you know Christ as your Savior, my friends? Do you know him as your Lord and Savior? Oh, you need to believe him. You need to believe the word of God. You name and not see the salvation. But Jesus Christ said in the book of John chapter 8 and verse 24 to those who are speaking to him, he said, if you don't believe that he is the Savior. In John 8:24, he said, if you don't believe that he is the Savior, the one who died for your sins and provides salvation, if you do not adhere and to put your trust in him, you will die in your sins. And if you die in your sins, you know that there is no repentance in the grave. And you will surely, without Christ, you'll go to hell. People don't want to hear that. But it's true. You truly will go to hell, my friends. Today could be the day of your salvation. Christ told Zacchaeus. We know about Zacchaeus. Christ told Zacchaeus in the book of Luke, today is salvation come to this house. Today. Not only for you, but for your whole house. You need Jesus Christ. Not only go to church. There's nothing wrong going to church. But when you go to church, my friend, you must listen to the word of God. And you need to make a decision. If you want to continue living the way you're living, or you want to turn your life to Christ, I will not force you. Neither God will force you to do that, my friends. Come to your house today. It is not a tomorrow salvation, my friend. Salvation is not a tomorrow salvation. It is a today's salvation, because you know why? The Bible, Proverbs tells us, 27 and verse 1 tells us, we must not boast ourselves of tomorrow. Don't boast ourselves of tomorrow. You know why? Because we do not know what the day may bring forth. never know that. What he bring forth. He may never know that. You may never know what he bring forth, my friend. Not a day will bring forth. We never know that. So by because of that, the Lord said to the book in Isaiah chapter 45, the Lord said, look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the world. For he is God. For there is none else. Salvation is important. You may not know. No matter how intelligent you are, no matter how eloquent you think you are, you can never know what tomorrow brings. Never. Only God knows. Make up your mind this afternoon. You have come to witness. You have come to listen. You have come to give support to this precious lady. But she made her path straight with God. And I'm hoping, I'm sure that she would want you to do the same thing with your life. Why salvation is important? Why is salvation now? You know why? Why is salvation now? Why we need salvation now? Because life, my friend, life is short. Life is short. 86 years of age. That's right. 86 years of age. Not many of us would wish there. Anybody can put up a hand and say, I will reach 86 years? Not one of us. Good life. 86 years. We may not reach there. Life was still short for her. She died. She died. We may not want try to define life. Don't try to do that at all. Some say that life is a moment of time given to us to prepare for eternity. Some say life is a long journey that will come to an end sooner or later. And it will come sooner or later. Sooner or later. But in the book of Genesis chapter 2, we find that life is a blessed live. Life is a blessed gift from God. Blessed gift. The Bible says that God breath blow into that piece of clay that he made. His life. So every one of us in this afternoon are breathing out what God put in us. It is his life, not ours. And we are behaving as though we have control over our life, and we tell ourselves, this is my life and I can do whatever I want with it. God is saying, no, this is my life. I will call for it any time that I desire. And you cannot stop it. He can call it now. And you cannot stop him. It's a blessed gift of God. So all you need to do is to enjoy it and then live responsibly before God. Because James tells us, what is your life? What is your life? James asks this question. What is your life? Can you answer this question? What is your life? Are you sure about your life? He said that our life is like a vapor, a passing fog. It is here, you see it now, and it disappears. We are here today, we are gone tomorrow. So learn to live our life responsibly to God. We must not tell ourselves that my life, that tell ourselves, this is my life. And no one will tell me how to live it. We don't have the control of our lives. We believe, some of us believe that our life, we are permanent. We don't have a permanent life here. Job tells us, referring to life, said the Lord giveth, and the Lord will take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And you're going to hear that this afternoon again. So when you go to bed, as you put your head on your pillow, we hope and pray that God will not take out his breath from our bodies. Anybody hear me this afternoon? Yes. I'm not that scared, you know. I'm telling the reality. Because we believe our life is permanent. But God can take it away anytime he wants. Life is like a vapor, my friends. It is here, we see it, and without warning, And no matter how bright we are, as I said before, no matter how intelligent we think you are, no matter what, we are so. We have no idea what will happen. God will do that. So what we have to say? We have to say like the psalmist. Psalm 90 and verse 13, we need to say like the psalmist, teach us to number our days and teach us number our days. In other words, what he's saying, teach us how to use wisely that all the time that we have with wisdom. Third reason, second reason, why we need to use salvation, because death is sure. We are going to die. No matter who you are, the rich, the poor, we are going to die. Solomon said, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 8 says, it's a time to be born and a time to die. He did not say where and when and when. He is telling us, in other words, that death is a reality. You understand that? That's what he said to us. It's a reality. We all must face one day. And the Apostle Paul confirmed that in the book of Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, where Paul is reviewing the fall of Adam and explain the power of sin and death. Paul says in that chapter, he says, death passed upon not some men, but on all men. No matter where we are, death is present. You cannot run from it. We cannot hide from it. Death is alive. He explained that to us. Death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. We cannot escape it. We cannot stop it. We cannot change its power. My friend, let me tell you, all the medical science and technology that we have, we cannot calm it. It is still powerful. You ever realize that? We have good technology. We have good sciences now. And good technology. But we still cannot slow it down. We cannot calm it. It will still happen no matter what. Because why? Because the facts are in the Bible. God tells us one of these days we are going to die. And must prepare for that. We must prepare for that. Yes. We must prepare for that. We cannot do anything about it. Yes. We cannot slow it down. Because the facts are already been established in the Bible. Romans 3 and verse 23, all have sinned. Romans 6 and verse 23, all are not, the wages of sin is death. Man is going to die. Man is not dying. Man is not dying because he is poor and he is struggling. That's not why man is dying. Man is not dying because, I'm saying that again, man is not dying because he's poor and he's struggling. Man is dying because of sin. The Bible tells us so. Whether we are morally good, religious, rich, intelligent, whether you're Christians, yes or no, when that time comes, my friend, we go. We go. We will go. And nobody can stop that. It will come. In the book of Luke, we have two men. The story of Lazarus and the rich man. He didn't go to hell because he didn't die because he was rich. And Lazarus not die because he was poor. But the Bible, both men died. The rich man died. Lazarus died first. Both men died. Different times. They went different places. Both men died. But they went different places. You know why? One was prepared. Lazarus was prepared, I believe. Yes. Because the way the Bible speaks about him, he was prepared for eternity. As you sit here, think about eternity. That one of these good days, when you leave your home, you will never come back. It happens all the time. You may end up in hospital. And you may end up by one of these funeral homes. Make up your mind, my friend. Salvation is important. Prepare to meet God. Prepare. Last this afternoon, death is a reminder that we have an appointment with it. Death is a reminder that we have an appointment with it. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27 tells us, for as it is appointed unto man, man wants to die. Appointment. Wants to die. And after this, the judgment. Let me say this afternoon, we have had the liberty or have the liberty to make changes. If we make an appointment in anywhere, whether lawyers, doctors, we have all the liberty to change or to cancel all of our appointments that we ever make. We can do that. I can make an appointment with a doctor tomorrow and then call him Tuesday morning and say, I'm going to cancel my appointment with you. I can call a lawyer. So the same thing. I make an appointment. I said, I can cancel it. But let me tell you this afternoon. Let me warn this afternoon, my friend. If there is one appointment we cannot cancel, it's the one with death. You know why? Because God is the one who established it. God said, one of these days, you are going to die. And you are going to face it. We cannot change it. Cannot change it. It's a reminder that one of these days we are going to die. Reflecting back now, just so we are, as we sit here this afternoon, there is a massive funeral going down in Clear Valley. Oh, a massive one. Those people left their homes the Sunday morning. They didn't reach. Today, there's a massive funeral down there in Clear Valley. My friend, this morning, what do you think of that? You can leave your home. I can leave my home and never come back. You don't have to lie in your bed. You have to lie in your bed. You can be at your workplace. When that appointment comes, you will go. You will go. You will go. Therefore, it's important. Let me remind you this afternoon that if you are not saved, my friend, as the apostle, as the prophet told the children of Israel in Amos 4 and verse 2, they need to prepare to meet God. You need to do this very thing, my friend. You need to prepare to meet God. Amos, in the book of Isaiah, Amos the prophet went to Hezekiah with a message from the Lord. And the message was, set thine house in order. Prepare. Set your house in order. Message that God gave the prophet Amos to King Hezekiah. Set your house in order. He was on his bed. Because you're not going to live. You're going to die. Oh, what a message. He didn't want to die. He began to pray. And God spare him and give us in order. You need to prepare to meet God. You never know when it will happen to you. Prepare now. Repent of your sins. As the Bible tells us. Repent, turn from your sins. And turn to Christ. Make Christ your Savior this afternoon. Make him your Savior. The question I'm going to ask you now. Is it well with your soul? Are you prepared for eternity? That's what I'm asking you to do it. Now is the time. And as we prepare ourselves to take the remains of our dear sister to that cemetery, I bid you farewell, sister. We'll meet again. We are going to meet.
You know me and I know you. We go to get together. I'll be your farewell now. Hope that one day, that those of you who are here, will give your life to Christ. It was about to do it. Now, sir, Father, this afternoon, we thank you. Bless the world. Help in all that. As we look to you, we bring Christ in. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Oh,
John, excuse me.
Okay, I'll hold on. Come, let me see the cabin, please. Wait.
You stick.
Wiggle. You already slapped me. Ready? Okay. All right. Okay. One more time.
Mommy, let me in.
We all want to go home, but we have to speak on talk, and I can't let them to disappear. I am the resurrection and the life. You have the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth. I shall stand the latter day upon the earth. Though after my skin worm destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we carry out nothing. The Lord giveth, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Man that is born of woman hath but a short time to live. He is full of misery. He cometh up and is cut down like a flower. He fleeth as it were a shadow. Never continue in one speech. In the midst of life, we are in death. Of whom we seek our help. And as far as much as that pleases the Almighty God, it is wise providence to take out the soul of our dear sister, Lottie. I saw the words. We therefore commit her body to the ground. Earth to earth. Ashes to ashes. Dust to dust. Looking for the general election in the latter day. Father, we pray this afternoon that you bring comfort the life of those who are here this afternoon. Who are bereaved, O God, is a road we will have to travel. But I pray, dear God, this afternoon that those who have come here to witness this burial will prepare themselves, O God, for that day. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Go ahead.
Yeah.
God, I'm coming, boy.
Please, sister, my own.
Trust love of Jesus. Mama.
Come on, sing it in the middle. Bring your heart to heaven. Here today, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Yeah.
When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory.
Amen.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more.
Praise the Lord, let the people.
rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he has done. Great things he has taught us. Great things he has done. And give him rejoicing. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he has done. Praise the Lord.
Joking. Oh, there you come. Right,
George.
I like my joke.
Does everybody know?
Yeah.
Tell them what I'm going to put it.
Ninja Man say, one love.
One love.
One love, dude.
Yeah. Thank you.
One love, dude.